Welcome to Bhakti Sangha Japa conference call. Today we are very fortunate. So on this auspicious day of Ram Navami, we are having Her Grace Preethi Vilasini Mataji to enlighten us on the topic surrender in Ramayana. So thank you so much, Mataji, for giving a valuable association in the nectar of Lord Ram past time. So thank you so much, Mataji. Now I would like to hand over the call to you, Mataji. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Pavitra Madhavi Mataji. Thank you for your warm introduction. Thank you very much. I was just reminded of how you would host the entire Ramkatha series earlier. Thank you so much. So we'll start with the prayers. Om Ajnana Tinirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Mukam Karoti Vachalam Tangum Langayate Girim Yat Krupatamaham Vande Shri Gurum Dina Tarinam Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Radhanath Swami Nitanamne Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nitanamne Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharini Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschati Desha Tharini Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Kujantam Rama Rameti Maduram Madurakshara Maruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Valmiki Munisimhasya Kavita Vanacharina Hashranvan Rama Kathanatham Konayate Paramgatim Veda Vedye Parepumsi Jati Dasharatatmaje Veda Pracheta Sadasi Sakshat Ramayanatmanaha Anjananandanam Viram Janaki Shokanashanam Kapisha Makshahantaram Vande Lanka Bhayankaram Manojavam Marudatulya Vegam Jitendriyam Buddhim Varishtam Vatatmajam Vanariyuda Mukyam Sri Ramadutam Shirasanamam Anjaneya Madipatanalanam Kanchanadri Kamaniya Vikraham Parijata Tarumulavasinam Bhavayani Pamanantanam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bhashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataha Raksha Santakam Hare Krishna. So I thank everyone for giving this opportunity to speak on this very wonderful topic from the Ramayana. We all know that the entire canon of Vedic literature is classified into the four Vedas, the Rig, Sama, Yajur and Atharva Vedas. And then we have the Vedanta, which is the Upanishads, which are at least 108 in number. Together, all of this is known as the Shruti, Shruti Shastra. And then we have the Smriti Shastras that constitute of the Puranas and the Itihasas. It is said that it is impossible to understand the real import of the Shrutis as it is by reading them directly. So to understand their real import, one must consult the Itihasas and Puranas, which are historical records. We see in the Tattva Sandarbha of Srila Jiva Goswami, he goes to a great extent to establish this fact that the Puranas become extremely important, the Itihasas become important, and he also goes to a great extent of establishing the supremacy of Srimad Bhagavatam in that light. So Puranas are historical records that were spoken of, and generally the events covered in a Purana are multiple events, and it is written by a realized soul, and it is written, these records were past records. That is recollected by a realized soul, like we see in the case of Bhagavatam, it was Shukadeva Goswami. He wrote down multiple stories, multiple historical records, or rather he said, and then Vyasadeva compiled it. And in Itihasas, what happens is, another realized soul is there, and he writes down records of one particular event, one particular story, when the events are happening. So that is the difference between Itihasa and Purana. So Itihasas means when the event is happening itself, there is a person who is alive there and who is writing it down. So we know that in the case of Ramayana, the Ramayana was written by Valmiki, who was present at that time when Ram was living. And it was just one story, the story of Lord Rama. Similarly, we see the Mahabharata, which is the other celebrated Itihasa. It was written by Vyasadeva, and Vyasadeva wrote Mahabharata when Mahabharata was happening right there. So like that, that becomes the difference between the Puranas and the Itihasas. Now, among the Itihasas, we know that among the Puranas, it is the Srimad Bhagavatam. In fact, Srimad Bhagavatam is the crest jewel of all the Vedic literature. There is no doubt about it. Now, coming to the Itihasas, we see that Vyasadeva, though he intended to glorify Lord Sri Krishna, he ended up writing so many topics and so many stories about different people like Duryodhan, Bhishma, Drona, Dhritarashtra, and so many others. And later, he regretted that he didn't focus enough on Krishna. But whereas when Valmiki wrote the Srimad Valmiki Ramayana, he was just focusing completely on Krishna, on Lord Sri Ramachandra. His story is dealt in great detail. And it is a very beautiful account. It is the greatest kavya ever known to mankind. So the Valmiki Ramayana, it begins with a very beautiful verse that goes like this. Tapasvadhyaya niratam tapasvim vakvidam varam naradam paripraccha Valmiki munipungavam. So Valmiki this Ramayana was written by the great sage Valmiki. Valmiki is Munipungavaha, very, very great sage, who existed at the time of Lord Ram. And this great epic which is known as Ramayana, begins with the scene where Valmiki had performed very great austerities, tapasvadhyaya niratam. He had performed very great austerities, and then he had a question, and that's when Narada enters, and he begins to ask Narada certain questions when he pays a visit to him. So how does he begin asking questions? He says, Konasmin sapratam loke gunavan kascha viryavan dharmadnyascha kratagnyascha satyavakyo dridavrataha. He asks him, who really is that person who's present in the world now, who's full of great qualities, who's got great virtues, who's chivalrous, who's very dharmic, who's very grateful, who's a speaker of truth, who's very firm, who's very determined? Like that, he goes on talking about 16 great qualities. So like that, when he asked about the 16 great qualities that a person living could possess, that is when Narada revealed to him about the glories of Lord Rama. And right away there, Narada narrated the Ramayana in brief. So the very first chapter of the Ramayana begins with a brief telling of the Ramayana by Narada Muni, which is called as the Sankshipta Ramayana. So later, then after this, sage Valmiki, he goes to the river Tamasa for a bath. And then there he sees a couple of birds, a pair of birds, and it so happens that a hunter kills one of them. So Valmiki, unintentionally, with anger, he utters a particular verse. This verse was rich in grammar, but he himself was very confused why he spoke such a curse in the form of a poem. He said, Ma nishada parishtaham tvam gamaha shashvati samaha yat kraunchanituna rekam varihi kama mohitam. He said, O violent hunter, by the reason with which you have killed one bird of the couple, when it was infatuated by passion, for this, that reason you will never get a state of peace for many years to come. So he cursed the hunter very much, saying that, see, you have killed one of the birds and you killed it out of passion. Why? When they were engaging in passion, why did you kill that bird? Because of that, you will never attain peace. So once he cursed, he became very resentful. He was thinking, why did I say such a bad thing? And that is when Lord Brahma appeared there and he said, it is all right. In fact, that will be the very first verse of the Valmiki Ramayana. So like this, very first verse of Valmiki writing down the Ramayana. So like this, Valmiki began writing down the Ramayana. Of course, this verse also had a different meaning, and Brahma explains that meaning, and he says that the same verse can also mean, oh, the abode of Goddess of Fortune, the Supreme Lord, by your killing of one male demon named Ravana, who in his passion abducted Sita, you eradicated the evil from earth. So the same verse had two meanings, and Brahma pointed out the other meaning and said, in fact, it is auspicious for you to begin your work with this verse. And then the epic began to flow from Valmiki. Just like how it is very easy to hold a gooseberry in one's hand, like that Valmiki could grasp and understand the entire events that happened in the life of Lord Ram, the past, present, and the future events that were happening during his time when Lord Ramachandra was walking the earth. Now, Ramayana is just not a story. We all have heard this over and over. It is an epic, it is a kavya, and it has several deep pastimes filled with realizations, values, lessons, and secrets. We call it rahasyas. And many acharyas have churned out the essence of the Ramayana. Just like how the body is made up of flesh, muscles, blood, and all this that we have in this body, it cannot hold up without a skeletal system. Similarly, the concept of one particular secret known as the Sharanagati or surrender is what holds up the entire Ramayana. It is like the skeletal system that holds up the body. So like that, it is this concept of Sharanagati that holds up the entire Ramayana. Sharanagati is in fact, or rather surrender in English as we say, it is the backbone of the entire Ramayana. And this concept is seen throughout the Ramayana, through all the seven cantos of the Ramayana. So the underlying message of the Ramayana in one word, if you ask, would be Sharanagati, which is the essence of this Ramayana. And the most important Sharanagati is the Vibhishana Sharanagati. So for today's analysis, I will be using instances from the Mula Ramayana, which is Valmiki Ramayana, to identify the various surrenders that has happened through the seven cantos. I will be using the Sri Vaishnava commentaries to explain them, to understand it in the light of the Acharyas. But for the Vibhishana Sharanagati, we will also analyze it using Prabhupada's purports and try to understand what is surrender in great depth using Valmiki Ramayana as the base. So we will hopefully cover the entire story of the Valmiki Ramayana, stop at points where important Sharanagatis were performed and analyze those Sharanagatis with the help of Acharya's commentaries. So that is the what I intend to do today, and it may go beyond 1 hour, but I plead to all of you to please hold on, and then we will have a very beautiful recital by a very young child who will recite the entire Ramayana in a prose format. It will take only 15 minutes, but he will do it. So, in the Padma Purana, in the Hari Bhakti Vilas 11.417, Srila Sanatana Goswami, then Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his poem Sharanagati, and in the purport of Bhagavad Gita 1866, Srila Prabhupada, he describes six symptoms of a surrendered soul, which is the six limbs of surrender. What is that word? Very famous. Anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam rakshishyati iti vishwaso guptritve varanam tata atmanikshepa karpanye shadvida sharanagati. This is the definition of sharanagati. So in scriptures, if someone asks what is the definition of sharanagati, then we have to quote this verse. Bhagavad Gita purport 1866, if you go, you will find the definition of sharanagati directly given there. Anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam rakshishyati iti vishwasah gotritve varanam tata atmanikshepa karpanye shadvira sharanagati. So the six aspects of full surrender to Krishna are accepting things that are favorable for devotional service, rejecting things which is not favorable for devotional service, believing very firmly in the Lord's protection, feeling exclusively dependent on the mercy of the Lord for one's maintenance, having no interest separate from that of the Lord, always feeling meek and humble before the Lord. Having defined what is Sharanagati, in simple terms, it should be understood that seeking shelter of the Lord with one's complete faith on the Lord in a mood of helplessness is called a Sharanagati in simple words. So these things, these angas should be seen. Sharanagati means going and seeking shelter, catching the lotus feet, saying, I have no gati, I cannot go anywhere but you. You are my shelter. And doing it with complete faith in a mood of humility. If you have all this, then you can do Sharanagati. This is the Sharanagati in simple terms. But of course, it has six limbs and it is being described in that particular verse. Now, let's start analyzing the different surrenders in Ramayana in different cantos and see which surrender was fruitful and which was not. For that, the very first surrender we see is in the Balakanda. So we will see the story of the Balakanda and we'll stop at the point of surrender. So in the Balakanda, Dasharath, he had requested sage Rishyashringa to perform a sacrifice from the Atharva Veda called as the Putra Kamishti Yajna to procure a son, because he didn't have a son for a very long time. At that time, Rishyashringa, he propitiated the Yajna for the sake of Dasharatha. At the same time, the demigods, they approached Lord Brahma and they told Brahma about the atrocities that Ravana was doing. So they said, oh Brahma, you have given this Ravana so many boons. With that, he's torturing the entire world. So you please do something so that we can all live in peace. He's doing a lot. So then Brahma thought for a while and he was thinking in his mind that the demon, he told that he cannot be killed by Gandharvas or Siddhas or demigods or demons. But he didn't mention about humans. So as Brahma was contemplating in his mind like that, at that time, the Lord, the Supreme Lord, the one who is the shelter of all the universes, exactly at that time, he appeared in front of them. Then the demigods, the Siddhas, the Gandharvas, Yakshas, the sages, all of them, they turned towards the Lord and they were so happy that the Lord had appeared there. And they said, oh Lord, we seek shelter at your lotus feet. Please give us shelter. Please take birth among the humans to kill that wicked Ravana. That was the first Sharanagati performed in the Ramayana. This is Balakanda, chapter 24, verse number 25. The Sharanagati performed by the demigods. Siddha Gandharva Yakshascha Tatasvam Sharanam Gataha. You can check out if you want the verse. So at that time, the Lord, the shelter of the entire universe, replied. He said, O Deva, please give up your fear. Demigods, give up your fear. I will destroy Ravana. I know he is the enemy of the demigods and sages. So therefore, I will go to the world of the human beings and rule over this globe for 11,000 years. So like this, having blessed the demigods with this boon and accepting to protect them, when they sought shelter, the Lord accepted to protect them and the Lord picked Ayodhya as his Janmabhumi and he descended. This is described in chapter 15 of the Balakanda. So then the Lord, who is a person who accepts anybody who seeks shelter at his lotus feet, immediately decided to descend and the Putra Kamishti Yajna was going on. So if one folds his palms and says, I am yours, Tavasmi, Tavasmi Tiyachite, if someone says, oh Lord, I am yours, then definitely he will protect. What to talk of the Supreme Lord? Even the Lord's own weapon becomes useless when one folds his palms in surrender. When one surrenders to the weapons of the Lord also, the weapon will stop attacking. So there is a story in the Mahabharata, and this story is very popular. There is an instance where Ashwatthama released Narayanastra, which Ashwatthama had procured from his father Dronadeva. So when from Drona, he had procured this particular weapon called as Narayanastra. And this Narayanastra is a weapon that comes from Lord Narayana himself. So there is no counter astra to it. Who can be greater than the Lord? There is no powerful astra that can ever counteract the Narayanastra, the Lord's personal weapon. So at that time, Krishna, he was telling the Pandavas, all the Pandavas, put down your weapons. Krishna told Arjuna, he told Bhima, he told everybody, all of you put down the weapons, ask all your army men to put down their weapons. What you should do is when the Narayanastra is approaching you, you fold your palms, pay respect and bow down in Dandavats to the Narayanastra. That is the only way to counteract the Narayanastra. So everybody, when Krishna gave this instruction to Arjuna, it was immediately relayed to the entire army and everybody immediately put down their weapons when the Narayanastra was approaching them, except our dear Bhima, who was thinking that it was an act of cowardice to surrender to an enemy's weapon. But then, Krishna, he told Arjuna, he prodded Arjuna and he told him, tell him it's, you know, this is Narayanastra, it's not a question of an enemy's weapon, ask him to put it down and then surrender. So finally everybody, forcefully, Bhima was restrained, it is described in the Mahabharata, he was forcefully restrained and then he was asked to put down all his weapons and everybody put down their weapons and they fell down and surrender. What happened? The weapon got nullified. That is the only way. Just bow down. All the problem is solved. So when one bows down, it works. That is surrender. So the Lord, coming back to Ramayana, the Lord, he decided to appear as Lord Sri Ramachandra, the son of Dasharath. And at that time, the demigods, all of them, all the demigods, Surya, Indra, everybody, all the demigods, they also descended among the Vanaras as assistants. That pact was made. The demigods surrendered and they decided to help. So they all decided to come down. Therefore, the surrender of the demigods, it bore a fruit because they surrendered to the right person who was the shelter of the entire universe. Ramachandra said, I will come, and he came. Then, why did he come? Why did he come? He came because to eliminate Ravana. So we have to keep the motive also in mind. He came down to eliminate Ravana, and in Borapur, we know that towards the end, Ravana was killed and the Devas became happy. Now then, Ramachandra, so he decided to descend. He appeared from the womb of Kausalya. Lakshmana and Shatrughna from Sumitra and Bharata appeared from Kaikeyi. They grew up very, very fast. Not much Balalila is described for Lord Sri Ramachandra. He was a very nice disciplined child, and unlike our little Gopal, who's always doing mischief. Ramachandra, very nicely, he grew up quickly and he was 12 years old. So when he was 12 years old, that is when sage Vishwamitra came to Dasharath's palace. And when Vishwamitra arrived, Dasharath immediately welcomed him, he thanked him, and then he asked him how he could be of help to the sage, and he promised the sage to give whatever pleased him. So at that time, Vishwamitra told Dasharath, see, you're a great king, and I'm sure you will not go back on your promise. I'm performing a very great sacrifice, and there are two demons named Maricha and Subahu who are creating a lot of problems. So therefore, it will be good if you can send someone very important. And he says, whom I want is Swaputram Rajashaldulam Ramam Satyaparakramam Kakapaksham Dharam Shuram Jeshtam Nedhatu Marhasi. Please spare that brave and courageous, truthful eldest son of yours, Sri Rama, whose black hair is curling on both sides of his cheeks. So like that, so beautifully, he requested for this most beautiful boy to come with him. And Dasharath, when he heard this, he just swooned. He said, oh, my son is less than 16 years old. Una shodasha varsho. He said, because Ramachandra that time was only 12 years old. So he said, until one becomes 16, how can he even go for a battle? How can he go and combat demons? So he said, he's not equipped. So therefore, I beg you, if you want, I will come with my army, but I cannot send Rama. However, later Vasishta convinces Dasharath that Ramachandra indeed is the most capable, and he was sent off with Vishwamitra. And as he goes with Lakshmana along with Vishwamitra, he hears a lot of stories about the Ganges, Lord Kartikeya, and then he hears about Ahalya and Vishwamitra, and after killing Tataka, Subahu, and driving away Maricha, protecting the sacrifice, they proceed on to Mithila. Then Vishwamitra, Rama, Lakshmana, they went into the kingdom of Mithila. Ramachandra strung and broke the bow of Lord Shiva, and then he married Sita Devi. So the Balakanda events moved on very fast. And then Parashuram heard this twanging of the bow, and he heard that the bow was broken, this great Shiva Dhanush was broken, and he appeared there very, very angrily. Angrily, he appeared in the assembly there, and he told Dasharath, who is this who has broken this Shiva Dhanush? So then Parashuram said, look here, I have the Vishnu Dhanush. So I challenge the same person who has broken the Shiva Dhanush to string this Vishnu Dhanush and take a name with it. Now, hearing these words of Parashuram, who was so angry, Dasharatha, he got very afraid. And Dasharatha, at this time, he surrendered to Parashurama. He folded his palms with his face downcast. He told Parashurama, this is a small boy. In your anger, please don't do anything to him. If you want, you can eliminate all of us. But if you eliminate Rama, then all of us are as good as dead. So, I surrender, please spare him. This was the next surrender, and it is described in Balakanda chapter 75. He folds his palms, face down cast, he says, I surrender, please don't do anything to my son. So it was a helpless appeal. It was a very helpless appeal. But did Parashuram recognize the surrender? Answer is no, he didn't. Parashuram ignored him. And he said, this boy is very strong. I want him to take an aim and prove his capability. This Sharanagati was a failure because it was done to the wrong person. The reason, why is he a wrong person? The reason is because Parashurama was a person full of anger. Though he was empowered by the Supreme Lord himself, he was a person full of anger. If one surrenders to a person whose anger is not controlled, who shows anger at the wrong time, whose anger is not of the right amount, who doesn't know how to retract his anger and control his anger, who shows the anger to wrong people, such a person shouldn't be surrendered to. That is, you should not go and surrender to such a person. He's a person who's unfit to accept surrender. Now a question may be asked. Narasimha was also very, very angry, right? He was very angry. He was roaring, and all the three worlds were shaking. But is he the right person? Yes, he is. Because as soon as Prahlad went and folded his palms, Narasimhadev could control his anger. And Narasimhadev was showing his anger for the right cause at the right time to the right person at that time. So therefore, this surrender of Dasharath to Parashurama failed. So we will build up the case till the end, and then we'll understand the important things, how we should surrender, to whom we should surrender, all that we can analyze as we proceed. So this is what happened. Two cases we dealt with. We saw the surrender of the demigods to the Supreme Lord, and he accepted the surrender and he came. Next we saw the surrender of Dasharath to Parashuram. It was a big failure. Okay. Then, what happened after that? So, after that, of course, Parashuram's pride was conquered by Lord Ramachandra. And then Rama, Sita, and all of them, they lived happily for 12 years. Then moving on to Ayodhya Kanda. Time went by. Dasharatha decided that Rama must be coronated as prince. But however, because of Mantara's poisoning, Kaikeyi's mind was changed. And she asked Dasharatha to give her two boons. By one boon, Bharat should be coronated and Rama should go to the forest for 14 years. So these were the two boons. And Rama, he decided to proceed to the forest along with Sita, who insisted to come with him. At that time, at that juncture, Lakshmana came running to him and he fell at the feet of Lord Ram and he begged Ram that he wanted to go with him. So this appears in the Ayodhya Kanda in chapter 31, verse number 1. He says, Sa bhratrushcharanau ghadam vipidya raghunandanaha. He goes and holds on to the feet of Lord Ram and he cries and he says, don't leave me. I am surrendering. Please take me. Okay, what was he surrendering for? He was surrendering so that he can serve. One can perfect surrender. Because the ultimate aim of surrender, the prayojana of surrender is seva, service. So he was holding the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra and asking for what? He was asking for the fruit of service, prayojana of service. So that was the mode of Lakshmana. When Lakshmana did this and he said, Aham sarvam karishyami jagrata swapatacha, he said, I will do everything. I will keep awake whether when you are sleeping or when you are moving in the forest. I will take care of you. I will do everything. I surrender. Please give me service. Then Lakshmana asked like that. Immediately Ramachandra said, okay, proceed with us. Come with me. So he said, I surrender to you. And at that time, when did he surrender? In fact, he surrendered when Sita was present with him. So that surrender was very complete because he surrendered when this compassionate internal potency of the Lord was present. At that time, he requested for service. So his surrender was so beautiful. He perfected surrender. So even when we chant the Mahamantra, we say, O Hara, engage me in the service of the Lord, right? So we request Radharani to engage us in the service of Sri Krishna. So therefore, when Lakshmana surrendered at that time, holding the feet of Lord Ram, Sita Devi was also present. So that Sharanagati was so beautiful. So like that, immediately Ramachandra agreed and he took Lakshmana and Sita to the forest. Ramachandra walked in the front, Sita in the middle and Lakshmana behind. And together, the three of them, they proceeded on to the forest. And of course, we know that initially they went with Sumantra and the chariot, and Sumantra leaving behind the Ayodhya Vasis. I mean, they tricked the Ayodhya Vasis to go back, and then he left behind Sumantra also later. They crossed the Ganges, and he took the friendship of Guha, and he was proceeding. So this was happening in the forest. Meanwhile, Bharat, who was in KK Desh at that time, had a very bad dream, and he and Shatrughna were called by some messengers to return to Ayodhya. So when he came to Ayodhya, he saw that everything and everyone was gloomy. He went and asked Kaikeyi what had happened, and she very carelessly said, "Your father has passed away and your brother has been sent to the forest so that I can crown you." And then Kausalya also didn't believe the true intentions of Bharata, and she thought Bharata didn't have any good intentions. Then Bharata immediately left to bring back his dear brothers. And on the way, again, he met Guha, he crossed the Ganges. And as he was going there, towards where Rama, Sita and Lakshman were stationed, where they had built a leaf hut, the horses of the chariots of Bharata's army, they were making a huge noise, rising dust that covered the entire sky. At that time, Lakshmana, he ascended a tree and he saw that a huge army was coming, and he could understand that it was Bharat who was coming. So immediately he informed Lord Ram that Bharat's army is approaching towards our hermitage. And Lakshmana, he expressed his apprehension to Ram, saying that the only reason Bharat is coming with the entire army is to kill both of us. He has no other intentions. So when Lakshmana said that, Rama, he got very upset. He said, "What are you talking? Do you want the kingdom? If you want, I will give you the kingdom. But don't suspect Bharat for anything." So Rama corrects Lakshmana for his misjudgment, and then as Bharata neared Ram's kutir where he was, Bharata and Shatrughna, the minute they saw Sita, Ram, Lakshman, they threw themselves at the lotus feet of Lord Ram. Ram embraced both of them, and then Bharata informed about Dasharath's death and requested eventually Rama to return. So Rama and Bharata, they conversed for a few chapters in the Ramayana, and Bharat gave so many reasons why Ram should return. He said, "Rama, you should return to the kingdom and keep it in order. Only you have the competence to save the entire world." Then Bharata, he surrendered to Ram. He said, "Iti yuktva nyapatat bratuhu padayur Bharata tada." This is how the verse starts. This is again in Ayodhya Kanda, chapter 112, verse number 14. So he says, Bharata, who was so kind-spoken, he made a fervent appeal to Lord Rama and fell at his feet, holding his feet, saying, "Come back to the kingdom." So this is a very important Sharanagati. Saying, catching hold of the feet of the Lord, saying, "You please come back." So you see, in the previous one, when Lakshmana surrendered, it was an immediate success. Immediately Ramachandra said, "Okay, come, let's go." You know, the very next verse he said, okay, you can come. Okay, but here, when Bharat, he fell at the feet, something different happened, right? So Ram, what he did was, he took out his sandals, he stepped on it, and then he got down and he gave the sandals to Bharata. And the padukas of Ramachandra was carried by Bharata, and these padukas were protecting Bharata's journey back to Ayodhya. And it was the padukas that ruled the most glorious Ayodhya. In fact, during the rule of the padukas, not a single mistake was committed. Not a single mistake was reported in the Valmiki Ramayana. So like that, padukas were extremely potent. So it appears to us that Bharat's Sharanagati actually failed, right? It appears like that. He went and requested the Lord to come, but the Lord didn't go. He just gave the padukas and he said, okay, bye-bye. Why? Of course, we can say the padukas are so potent, it has the dust of the lotus feet of the Lord. Of course, yes, definitely correct, yes. But however, the reason that this happened, that Lord Ramchandra didn't go immediately, and how to analyze the surrender of Bharata, is that actually Bharata surrender did not fail. It did not fail, but however, it was delayed. Right? It was delayed, but not denied. This is a common thing we say about God. When we offer prayers to the Lord, we say it will not be denied, but it may be delayed. So the question is, why was it delayed? See, Ramchandra, he went back to Ayodhya only after 14 years. There was a delay, but it was not denied. So the question is, why was it delayed? It was delayed because already one surrender had been performed by the demigods to the Lord. And the Lord, in that surrender, what did he say? He promised the protection and elimination of Ravana. So for that, he had started his mission to go to the forest. So unless he goes to Ravana's place, how is he going to eliminate Ravana? So therefore, this Sharanagati of Bharat was conflicting with the purpose of the previous surrender of the demigods. Therefore, it was not denied, but it was delayed. The Lord never denies anyone who has taken shelter at his lotus feet. So instead of he going, the Lord gave his superior unmatchable sandals or the padukas to Bharata so that Bharata can have solace for those 14 years. And after the 14 years, Ramachandra kept up his promise, gave shelter to Bharata, and he went back. So that was the unique case of Bharata's falling down at the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra. Then as we proceed further, Rama, Sita, Lakshmana, they went to Atri Anasuya's ashram. They received the ornaments of Anasuya, and then they went to Bharadwaj ashram. They proceeded on to the Dandakaranya forest. So we are entering the Aranyakanda. In the very first chapter of the Aranyakanda, we see that the first surrender was performed. The sages of Dandakaranya, they approached Rama and they said, Tevayam Bharata Raksha Bhavadadish Bhava Vishaya Vasinaha Nagarastho Vanastho Va Tvam No Raja Janishwaraha. You alone can protect us because we are subjects living in your kingdom. Whether you are in the forest or you are living in the capital, you are our king and you are the only one who can protect us. This is, I believe, in the 20th verse of this chapter, first chapter 20th verse, Aranyakanda. So what did they do? They sought out to Ram for shelter. They went to Ram and they said, please protect us, they asked him. Why were they asking for protection? Why were they asking for shelter? Because there were 14,000 demons headed by Karadushan and Trishiras who were troubling the yajnas and the austerities and the sacrifices that were performed by all these sages. So at that time, Rama promises them protection and he proceeds further. He gives a promise and he proceeds further. As he proceeds further, he encounters Virada, and then he goes on to the several ashrams of the sages, and then finally he comes across Shurpanaka. Shurpanaka, the great lady, she enters the scene. Lakshmana, he cuts off the nose and the ears of Shurpanaka and sends her. What does she do? She goes and reports the matter to Karadushan, and then Lord Ram, he encounters Karadushan and Trishiras and others. And that time, Lord Ramachandra, single-handedly, in 1.5 muhurtas, he fights with all of them. Single-handedly, he sends away Sita and Lakshmana to watch from a distance and be safe, protected in a cave, so that he could fulfill the promise of the sages. The sages had sought shelter of him, and he single-handedly destroyed all those demons. He sent away Lakshmana and Sita. But he left one person, Akampana. He always leaves one person, Ramchandra. We see Maricha Subahu, he left Maricha. So like that here, he left one of them, who's Akampana, who was the reporter who went and told Ravana about the matter, that Karadushana are all dead. Then after he killed and he fulfilled the promise of the sages, that time Sita Devi, she comes out of the cave. And there's a very beautiful verse, Tam Drishtva Shatruhantaram, Maharshi Naam Sukam ahvayam babhuva srishta vaidehi bhartaram parishvaje. That means Sita, she was so happy and delighted seeing that Rama had given so much happiness to the sages by destroying them. So she came out and she embraced her husband Rama very, very happy with so much love. So Ramachandra doing this, Sita was so happy, he kept up his promise. Sita came and embraced him like that. It's so beautiful how Ramachandra gave shelter to the sages in the forest. So then successfully after this incident, they proceeded further. And then the Sharanagati of the crow, who was the son of Indra, is discussed. I will be discussing. But actually, this is spoken of only in the Sundarakand, in the Mula Ramayana, which is the Valmiki Ramayana. Only in the Sundarakand, the story comes. But the story is being told that it happened during the Aranyakanda time. So therefore, we will deal with the surrender of that crow. What happened to that crow? We will talk about it. So technically, this happened in the Aranyakanda, but it was described only in the Sundarakanda. And when it was described, when was it described? It was described when Hanuman asked Sita to tell him something with which it could be established to Lord Sri Ram that Hanuman really met Sita only. Okay, so at that time Sita told Hanuman about something that happened very privately between Rama and Sita, which only Ram and Sita knew. What was that? Once when Rama and Sita were sitting on the banks of a river, Lord Ram was resting his head on the lap of Sita as he was lying down. At that time, a crow came and started first pulling Sita's skirt. Sita was shooing away the crow. Then it flew and sat on the breast of Sita Devi, yearning for some flesh. It wanted to take some flesh. So it started pecking on her chest at that time. And as it was pecking on her, it was so painful that blood was coming out from Sita's chest. And Lord Ram, he got wet by the discharge of the drops of blood that was coming from Sita's body. So Ram, seeing that she was being pierced so violently on the breast, immediately he asked Sita, who has wounded that? Who wounded you like this? And angrily he looked up, he saw a crow with blood at its beaks, and he took a blade of grass and he converted it into an astra and he released it at this crow. Now, as Rama threw this blazing kusha grass that went towards the crow, this blade of grass that went chasing that crow everywhere in the sky. Then, while that blade of grass came chasing that crow, he went to different places. Where was he going? Why was he going to different places? He was seeking protection. He was going everywhere asking for protection from that astra of this darba, that darba which Lord Ramachandra cast on him. So he was seeking protection. He went everywhere. He went in search of his father, Indra. His father couldn't protect him. Then he went to all the demigods. The demigods couldn't offer protection. He went to the sages. The sages didn't offer protection. Finally, he sought refuge in Lord Ramachandra. He came and fell down at Lord Ram. Now, yes, Lord Ram protected him. Okay, Lord Ram gave him protection. What did he do? His Brahmastra that he had already released, transforming that kusha grass into Brahmastra, it cannot go waste. Once an astra is released, it will not go waste. It has to take out something. So what he did, he used that kusha grass to remove the eye of the crow. Therefore, he removed the right eye of the crow, and the crow saved its life. The crow was given its life. That was the shelter that was given to the crow. Now, there is a question. Okay, this question is quite interesting. See, we have seen a similar situation in the case of Durvasa and Ambarish. What happened? Sudarshan Chakra was chasing Durvasa everywhere in all the three worlds. It went everywhere. It didn't find shelter. Finally, it came to the feet of the Lord. It went to the Lord. That time, what did the Lord say? Nobody else can protect you but except the person whom you have offended. Unless you beg forgiveness from the person whom you have offended, I cannot save you, right? So now, if Ramachandra is saving this crow, at least its life, okay? Ramachandra is not giving love of God, but at least he's saving the crow of its life, right? Then is it contradictory? Because the crow did offense to Sita Devi. So when this point comes, it is interesting that Padma Purana is quoted here that when this incident happened, the Acharya's quote Padma Purana, that when the crow came and fell at the feet of Lord Ram, he actually stepped on the feet of Lord Ram and sat on it like that, telling, give me shelter. The mood was not proper. The crow's mood was not proper. At that time, Sita nudged the crow. She kind of pushed the crow so that the crow's head would touch the feet of Lord Rama. Sita's touch, that is, Sita forgiving the crow and encouraging the crow to take surrender, pleased Ram, and Ram gave surrender to the crow. So all this was happening there in that scene, and they quote from Padma Purana. Honestly, I don't have the exact verse of the Padma Purana, but this was an interesting piece of information which I wanted to share, and this is directly from the Acharya. So like that, when the crow fell at the feet of Lord Ram, recommended by Sita, to whom the crow had done offense, Rama, he saved the crow. He did not kill the crow. Another reason why he didn't kill the crow is because in Ramayana, if you see, nowhere has Ram killed any demon in the direct presence of Sita. That's why he will send Sita away from the scene if he had to kill a demon. Now, if he kills this asura, this crow, right away, then it will be, Sita will not agree. Sita will stop him. So all this is there. Such logic are all explained. So therefore, this crow was saved and the crow did not die. This Sharanagati was fruitful because it was directly surrendered to the Lord in the presence of Sita, recommended by Sita. Therefore, it was fruitful. Now, moving further, Akampana, he went and he reported the matter about Ram's killing of Karadushan and others, and Ravana sent Maricha, who was the uncle of Ravan, to go as a golden magical deer, allure Sita, and somehow bring Sita. Then Rama and Lakshmana were away. So it so happened that Sita saw this golden deer and she asked Rama to fetch the deer. And at that time, Ram went chasing the deer. Lakshmana followed him. And then Ravana came in the guise of an ascetic or a sage and he kidnapped Sita. And while going in the Pushpak Viman, Sita, she dropped a cloth tied with her ornaments to the Rishimukha Parvat. And then she was stopped by Jatayu. Ravana and Jatayu were fighting, and then finally Ravana successfully kidnapped her, took her to Lanka and kept her in Ashokavan, and that scene closes there. Now, Rama and Lakshmana, they then went in search of Sita, and they saw Jatayu on the way, and they asked Jatayu what had happened, and then he does the final rites of Jatayu, and then Rama Lakshmana, they reach Pampa Sarovar. There Rama was a sakshi for Shabari's liberation. She was already promised liberation by her spiritual master, so he was only a sakshi for the liberation, and then he went to Rishyamukha Parvat to go and see Sugriva and ask Sugriva for help. At that time, Hanuman came in guise of a wandering bhikshu to check out on Ram, Lakshman and see who they were, and then they were respectfully taken to Sugriva. And Rama and Sugriva, at that time, they took an oath of friendship surrounding the fire, and then he said he would help Rama to find Sita. So when Sugriva was telling his story about the fight with his brother Vali, at that time it so happened that Sugriva mentioned that he went and fell at the feet of Vali and asked Vali for raksha. He went and fell at the feet of Vali and tell Vali, please forgive me, I surrender. Okay. And he told Vali, I did not purposely close the cave wanting you to die there. In spite of falling at his feet, begging him, Vali did not budge. He said, I beg to you with my bowed head, with my prayerful arms closed. That is basically he was doing, he was performing the Anjali, and he was saying, that I beg you, I fall at your feet with my head bowed down. I'm asking you, please, I want to return this kingdom to you. I only took charge because the residents needed a king, because they asked me. That is the only reason I took charge. But I had no intentions of killing you. So, but this failed because Vali kicked him out. He said, get lost. And he sent him away with a piece of cloth. He shooed him away. Though he was crying and begging him, in spite of it. According to the rules of Sharanagati Dharma that is described in the Mahabharata, in the Shanti Parva, a person to whom someone comes and surrenders, they should not, disregard such a person. If someone goes and surrenders to a person, he must be immediately forgiven or set free. Even in the codes of warfare, you see in the Mahabharata, it goes on and on. If someone goes and catches hold of the feet of the opponent and say, just forgive me, I'm not able to fight with you, the person to whom forgiveness is asked should immediately forgive and leave him, set him free. He cannot kill him at that time. This is a rule. Okay? But, or he cannot, maximum they do is they just forgive or they, sometimes, yes, we do see that, he's being defamed or something like that. So, this is the dharma of Sharanagati. If someone comes and surrenders to a lotus feet and says, give me shelter, please protect me, you should give protection. If you don't give protection, then Mahabharata says in the Shanti Parva, it is mentioned, if one doesn't give protection to such a person who's begging at your feet, then such a person acquires a sin which is greater than killing a Brahmana. And he is fit to be killed. The person who didn't give shelter, such a person is fit to be killed. This is a rule according to Dharma Shastras. So the surrender of Sugriva to Vali was a failure because Vali was incapable. He was incapable of following even these simple codes of Dharma. So Sugriva was surrendering to the wrong person. We saw even so many people surrender to the wrong person and it became a failure. So like this, Sugriva, he surrendered to the wrong person, Vali, and it was a huge failure. Then later, of course, Rama killed Vali and he made Sugriva the king of the Vanaras. And after the Chaturmasya time, Sugriva did not make any efforts to search for Sita. So Lakshmana got furious and he went to the residence of Sugriva. And Hanuman immediately saw this furious Lakshman coming out and he went to Sugriva and called him and asked him to come out. At that time, Sugriva was with Tara in that room. So that time Sugriva, hearing Lakshmana's voice, he got scared and then he sent Tara to go and pacify Lakshman. So Tara, who's known to speak very sweetly, she went to manage the situation. Meanwhile, Sugriva kind of, he washed his face and he came in front of Lakshman and he said to Lakshman, I beg forgiveness to you. He fell down, bowing down to the feet of Lakshman. He said, I beg forgiveness. I am very, very sorry. I am a Vanara. Please do not say, I will not forgive you. Because in this world, who has not committed mistakes? These are the words of Sugriva. This is there in chapter number 36, verse number 20, verse number 11. Yeah, chapter 36, verse number 11. So, Kishkindha Kanda, it says, Yadi Kinchit Ati Krantam, it starts like that, the word starts like that, where Sugriva says, who in this world has not made any mistake, I beg you, please don't say you will not forgive me, I fall at your feet. So that time, Lakshmana, hearing this, he became so pleased with Sugriva that he immediately forgave him, immediate. Lakshmana was known to be so angry, so easily, such a person, he immediately forgave him. So, he said, at that time, Lakshmana, he replied to Sugriva, immediate, next second, Lakshmana said, Sugriva, you are the one who is worthy to be a king. You have so much valor and vigor, and you are the only one who is capable of helping Ram. So, like this, he started glorifying Sugriva, seeing the mood of Sugriva. He did a mistake, but immediately he understood that he made a mistake, and he fell at the feet. And it was Lakshmana who protected him at that time. Why? because Lakshmana is the immediate expansion of Lord Rama, and he had the natural quality of forgiveness like Lord Rama. Anyone who sought shelter at his lotus feet, he will protect. So we all know how the different expansions of the Lord, they're all very potent. You go and surrender to them. In fact, we know that when we speak about Balaram, for that matter, we talk about how Balaram is so compassionate. Lord Nityananda is so compassionate. So that compassion factor is strongly present in them. Immediately, they will give shelter and they will take us to the Supreme Lord. So this is how it works. Next, moving further, Sundarakanda. So in Sundarakanda, all the Vanaras, what happened after this, Sugriva said he will take care of the situation and he will dispatch the Vanaras to different places to go in search of Sita. So he sent all the Vanaras in different places, and one batch of the Vanaras, they went to the southern direction and they reached this mountain called as the Mahendragiri. There they met Jatayu, and Jatayu saw 100 yojanas away. With his sight, he could see that there was a beautiful woman sitting under a Simshupa tree, and she was looking towards north very, very sadly. So immediately Jatayu said, I know this is Sita. And Hanuman, he crossed the ocean to reach Lanka, and he searched for Sita, and Hanuman found her under that tree. And this is when she actually tells the Sharanagati of that crow who was Indra's son. After this, what happened was, Trijata, she got a dream. After all this happened, Trijata, she got a dream. Sita was sitting there in Ashokavan. She was tormented by all these demonesses. Trijata was one of the demonesses, but she was a good demoness. What happened to Trijata? She had a dream. In that dream, she saw Ravana with red clothes, drinking hot oil with open hair, going towards the southern direction. Whereas contrastingly, she saw Rama and Sita wearing nice white clothes, traveling towards north. So basically, it means that they were going to a higher destination, and this Ravana, he was going to hellish conditions. Not only did she see Ravana going down to hellish conditions, she saw many other demons along with Ravana going down like that to hellish conditions. And she saw only Rama and Sita were, amount a chariot, and they were going up into the sky. At that time, she also saw Vibhishan. Vibhishan was also very nicely going up to the sky protected. But the rest of the brothers of Ravana were all being punished and they were going downwards. So when she saw this dream, she immediately woke up and she screamed out and she called out to all the demonesses and she told them, you demonesses, all of you surrender to Sita. She said, immediately go and seek forgiveness for Sita and take her shelter. Sita is the daughter of Janaka and she will be pleased if you all fall at her feet, and she is very competent to give us protection from this great danger. These are the words of Trijata. This is again recorded in the 27th chapter, verse number 45, the words of Trijata. But at that time, in Sundarakanda, of course, but at that time, the demonesses, they did not surrender. They did not surrender. They were just looking at Trijata. Oh, really? This is what happened? They were just looking at her. They did not go and surrender, though she said that. They just heard it and they kept quiet. However, okay, later, when Hanuman returned to Sita to take her back, this happens in Yuddhakanda. We are just jumping to Yuddhakanda, but we'll come back to Sundarakanda. Okay, we are just going to jump for a minute because we have to see what happened. Trijata said, all of you surrender. These demonesses, they just kept quiet. They just heard her words and they were like, okay, that's all, nothing. They didn't go and catch the feet of Sita and say, I'm sorry. They didn't do anything. Okay, but later, when Hanuman, after all this war was over, Hanuman comes and meets Sita to give the message that Ravana was conquered. At that time, Hanuman told, if you permit me, O Devi Sita, I will kill all these notorious female demons by whom you were frightened and who tortured you so badly. So at that time, Sita said, who is going to kill maid servants who were prodded by their master? I just forgive them. Please don't harm them. So don't speak like this, Hanuman. I'm just forgiving all the maid servants of Ravana here. Like that. She was so compassionate. Even before those demonesses, though they were told to take shelter, because they were in her presence for so long, just being in her presence itself, Sita forgave them. She's so compassionate. That is the nature of Sita Devi. For Rama, you should go and surrender. For Sita, nothing. That, you know, little bit also. You take her association, she will be so compassionate. She's ready to forgive. So she says, Dasi naam Ravanasyaham Marshayamiha Durbala. This is from Yudhakanda, 113 chapter, verse number 42. She says, I am ready to forgive them even before they surrender. Don't worry about all that. They didn't take protection, it's okay, but still I am ready to forgive them. So therefore, it is said, who can compare to the internal potency of the Lord? She is so compassionate. That's why, again, when we chant Mahamantra, we call out, oh, Hara, engage me in the service of Rama or Krishna. Why? 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 Because she is so compassionate. Radharani is the way to Krishna. Because she's so compassionate. Even before you fall and beg, she's ready to help you. You just have to take a little effort. Little. Just show some interest, she will help you. Take her association a little, she will help you. She will take you to the Lord. She's like that. Very, very compassionate in heart. So we see the associates of the Lord, be it either his immediate expansion or be it his internal potency, they are so merciful in nature, extremely merciful. So then moving on, after the Trijata's dream is described, Hanuman, he lit fire to the entire Lanka and he returned to Lord Rama and Rama embraced him with love. So we are technically entering Yuddha Kanda. So Rama, he embraced Hanuman with love and immediately Rama and the entire army, they marched towards the ocean. There, they were stationed there in the ocean, in the region of the ocean. Meanwhile, Bibhishan, he left the palace of Ravana and he decided to take shelter of Lord Ramachandra. Bibhishan was having a great fight. He was not agreeing to what Ravana was saying. Then he fought with Indrajit and then Ravana told him, you get out. So Bibhishan said, good riddance. And he flew from the sky with four of his associates and he crossed the ocean and he reached the shore of the ocean where all the Vanaras were stationed along with Rama. Now, who caught the sight of Vibhishan descending? It was Sugriva. So Sugriva and the other monkeys, when they saw this Vibhishan coming down from the sky like that, they went running to Lord Rama. And Sugriva went and told that this brother of Ravana by the name Vibhishan, he is coming here and he is saying that he has left the company of his own brother and he has come here to take shelter. What did Vibhishan say? Vibhishan, he said, Nivedayat mam shitram raghavaya mahatmane sarvaloka sharanyaya Vibhishanam upastitam. That means he told Sugriva, please inform Raghava immediately. Raghava, who is the greatest of all, who is the protector of all the three worlds, Sarvaloka Sharanya, that I, Vibhishan, have come here. In one sentence, Vibhishan praised Ramachandra as Raghava. He praised him as Raghava. Why Raghava? We'll see. He also praised him as Mahatma. He said, Nivedayat mam shipram Raghavaya Mahatmane. Raghava, he called. Mahatma, he said. Then he said, Sarvaloka Sharanyaya Vibhishanam Upasthitam. He is Sarvaloka Sharanya. So if you understand what Vibhishan is saying, he said, please go and inform immediately that Vibhishan come here. Hurry, go immediately. Go shipram, go fast, Sugriva. Why is he saying immediately? He is asking Sugriva to hurry and go and tell Rama that he is here to surrender. So surrender should be done immediately. That's what Vibhishan is telling. Shipram, go fast, Sugriva. Go and tell that Vibhishan is here to surrender. So we have taken this human form of life after many births. Human form of life is very, very rare. And the perfection of human life, as the Brahma Sutra state, is Athatho Brahma Jignyasa. So why are you here? You are here to inquire unto the Supreme. Not just inquire and keep quiet. What you should do, you should also surrender to the Lord. So we have heard so many times this verse from Bhagavad Gita. Sarva dharman parityajyami kam sharanam rajaham tuam sarva papebhyo mokshishyami ma sucha. We speak about it over and over. So we must understand that surrender is not something we postpone. It should be done immediately, as fast as possible. We should not think, okay, I will take up the Krishna consciousness after I become 70 years old, when I have time to do it. It should be done immediately. You should go and you should surrender to the Lord and say, you are everything to me. So Vibhishan, he demonstrated that here. He said, don't waste time. Go, hurry, go tell Ram I am here. Then he calls Rama as Raghava. Why? Because he's saying that I'm not surrendering to some person who's not very easily approachable. Today morning in the class, we heard about this point of Saushilya Saulabhya of Lord Sri Ramachandra, most important quality. It was a full class on that actually. Very, very beautiful. So we should go and surrender to someone who's very approachable. That's why he calls him Raghava, because this is Rama, he has come in the lineage of Raghu. He has come as a human being, or rather he's moving around like a human being. Though he's the Supreme Lord, he's moving around like the human being in the race of the Raghus, in the dynasty of the Raghus. Therefore, he's called as Raghava. So he's so easily approachable, he has come here. So that is the inner meaning that Vibhishan is saying. Said, he's so easily approachable, he has come here as Raghava. I can approach him very easily. And even if we think that Vibhishan got the opportunity to approach Raghava, but I am not getting the opportunity, that is not true, because God himself is not someone that we don't have any idea about. By the mercy of our Guru Varga, by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, by the mercy of sadhus, by the mercy of Shastra, which is again very important, we have all the information about God. Prabhupada has given so many books describing God, his abode, his activities, his pastimes. So much information is given. We know each so many details. So therefore, we are also as fortunate as Vibhishan. We are also having a Lord about who is accessible. He's definitely accessible. And then Vibhishan, of course, he's saying that I am here to surrender unto Raghava. And I want to surrender immediately. I am waiting to surrender to that Lord who is waiting for me to surrender. Because he's so approachable. Krishna is waiting for us. Rama is waiting for us. When we will come, when we will come. So I am waiting to surrender to him. Then, next, he addresses him as Mahatma. Why Mahatma? Because the Lord is just not some man. He's not just some human being. No. He's not like this. Rama is just some Kshatriya king who's one among many kings. Because he's so easily approachable. Not only is Rama so easily approachable, but also he is Mahatma. He is the greatest of all. What sort of Mahatma? He is the Paramatma. He is the super soul. He is the most worshipable of all. He is not even any ordinary Mahatma. He is the Paramatma. He is the supreme worshipable Lord. Then this Vibhishan, he uses the word Sarvaloka Sharanya. In fact, he is the only person who is worthy of taking surrender. Whom should we surrender to? We should surrender to someone who is the most capable. This Rama, he is Sarvaloka Sharanya. He is the only shelter of all living beings in all the three worlds. He is the only person who is worth even surrendering to. Krishna or Rama has another name called as Achyuta. Achyuta means one who never fails. If we go and catch his feet, he will not fail us. We have seen throughout the Ramayana so many Sharanagatis. Did Achyuta fail anybody? No, he will not fail anyone. To that Lord I have come to surrender. To that great Lord, Sarvaloka Sharanya, I have come to surrender, Vibhishan said. So like that he told Sugriva, immediately go and tell this Raghava, Mahatma, Sarvaloka Sharanya that I have come. So like this, Vibhishan, he describes the quality of the person to whom we should all surrender to. Whom should we surrender? We should surrender to only that person who has all these qualifications. When we go and surrender to someone who doesn't have these qualifications, you will be failed. We saw all these failures throughout. Why did it fail? Because they went to the wrong person. No. If you really want shelter, go to the right person. Now, what is the qualification for a person to surrender? What is my qualification if I want to surrender? Actually, there is no qualification. Anybody can surrender. Whether you are a demon, whether you are an animal, whether you are a bird, whether you are a woman, whoever you may be, you can surrender, but do it to the right person. That is the secret of the Vibhishan Sharanagati. Do it to the right person, irrespective of who you are. Vibhishan was a demon. Gajendra was an animal. Jata, Draupadi, she was a woman, and that too, she was in a condition where she was off the altar, you know, and that time also you can surrender. Of course, you don't go on the altar to deity worship, but still you can surrender in your heart at that time. She raised her arms and she called out to Krishna. She said, you are the only person who can protect me. I cannot protect myself. She left the other arm that was holding on to a sari and she raised her arms. So that is surrender. That is surrender. Anybody can surrender. The time, place, circumstance. Oh, maybe today I cannot do it. No, it's not like that. All this is not needed for surrender. All that we have to do, we have to do it with a correct, with our heart and soul. So, Vibhishan, of course, you know, he came there. You know, one can argue, oh, he has come. He's just come to see the Lord. Why doesn't he first go to the ocean and take his bath and do his japa and then come and meet the Lord? Is that the way you surrender? No. When you're in trouble, you should just surrender. You should just call out. All these prerequisites are not needed. If you can do it, that's great, but it's not needed. We must do it immediately to the right person, not to some random unqualified person. It should be done to the Supreme Lord. And the person who's surrendering, what mood should he have? We have said anybody can surrender, but he should have a particular mood. Okay, Srila Prabhupada describes this in great detail in all his purports, and we'll be picking from Srila Prabhupada's purports to understand this properly. A person who is surrendering must be akinchana. Akinchana means na kinchana. Kinchana means something. So na kinchana means one who has nothing to possess. Such a person is called akinchana, who doesn't have anything, who's completely convinced that nothing belongs to me. He is akinchana. He has the understanding everything is for Krishna. Everything is Krishna's. If one becomes a devotee of Krishna, he has to have this mood of akinchana, pridelessness. That's why Krishna's another name is akinchana gochara. Tvam akinchana gochara. If I'm not wrong, it is there in Kunti's prayers. I could be wrong, but it is there. Tvam akinchana gochara. In one of the prayers, you will see mostly Kunti's prayers. That's how she glorifies her. You are the shelter of the most fallen who don't have anything with them. So Krishna can be understood only by an akinchana who thinks himself very humble and meek. Only in such a mood can one surrender. Besides being akinchana, one must be ananya bhak, Prabhupada says. Ananya bhak means without deviating his attention to any other demigod or any other business. So, ananya bhak means simply concentrated on Krishna. That is very required without any deviation. And what is the deviations that we can have? Sometimes we become inclined to become a devotee for some material benefits. So, it is said ananya bhakti means without any deviation, without any material profit, you have to become a pure devotee. Then only you will attain the spiritual world. To attain the spiritual world, you should develop these two qualities. When you go to the Lord for surrender, it is very, very important. So, whatever the difficult situation may be, we should know that Krishna will save. This is called as Sharanagati. Avashya Rakibe Krishna Vishwasa Palana. The Sharanagati means, surrender means, Krishna will save me. I will not do anything against devotional service, even if there is torture. Just like how Prahlad Maharaj, he was tortured by his father, Devaki. Krishna's mother was tortured by her brother, Kamsa. Not some outsider, but her own cousin brother was torturing her. Kamsa, he was thinking, this Devaki is going to challenge my personal sense gratification, so I will finish her. That much torture he was giving to Devaki. But Devaki, she was always in the mood of surrender. We should be sure that Krishna will save. We've got so many instances as Prahlad, we see how Prahlad Maharaj was saved even under dire circumstances by Narasimhadev from the hands of his own father, Hiranyakashipu. Devaki and Vasudev, they were saved from the hands of Kamsa. So one who surrendered will be protected by the Lord. Okay, so that confidence should be there, and Prabhupada goes to great depths to explain this. What should be your qualification? How you should go? What you should reject? What you should take? All these should be very clear when one surrenders. There's another thing here Vibhishan is demonstrating, which is very, very important in Vibhishan Sharanagati. Vibhishan says, he tells Sugriva, please go and tell. Meaning what? Not that he's asking Sugriva, hey, you're a servant, you go and tell. No, the mood of Vibhishan was, you are an associate of Lord Ramachandra, so therefore you recommend me. That was the mood. So this is another thing in Vibhishan Sharanagati. He goes and he requests Sugriva to tell Rama that he wants to surrender. So therefore, when we go to surrender to the lotus feet of the Lord, we catch hold of the Acharya's lotus feet and we ask him, please, through you, I want to surrender. That is where the Acharya comes in the picture. So through another devotee, you go to the Lord. So that is what Vibhishan is showing here. Asking Sugriva, Shipram, go fast. And tell her that I'm standing here and waiting for him to accept me. So like that, Vibhishan to the Lord. Now, Sugriva, he heard these words of Vibhishan and he ran to Rama and Lakshman. There is an enemy who has come here and he belongs to Ravana's army and he surely come to kill us in the first opportunity. Now, these demons, he said, they can assume any form and they can disappear at any time. They are so strong, they are so deceitful. So therefore, he can be a spy of Ravana. So therefore, he's trying to come between us and create something. So this demon cannot be accepted. How can we keep our trust on him? Now, the younger brother Ravana, by the name Vibhishan, who had come, appeared to Sugriva that he was only a spy from Ravana to create some confusion. Sugriva, when he was sent to Rama, he didn't understand Vibhishan. He couldn't understand. Went and told all this. Why was he telling that to Ram? The reason he was telling all this to Ram is because he was protective of Ram. So all the devotees, one side Vibhishan was going and surrendering, another side Sugriva was, you know, talking. The intention of Sugriva initially was only to be protective of Ram. Oh, Ram, we may run into issues. That is what he was. Not that he was against Vibhishan in any way. He was only trying to, you know, protect his own dear. So, all this, in his mind, he was thinking how I can give protection to Vibhishan. Because Sugriva on his part was thinking how I can protect Ram, and Rama on his part, he was thinking, oh, a person has come to surrender to me. But then Rama looked at the other monkeys and he asked, and everyone, they pretty much said whatever Sugriva said, but they said it in a more polished manner. And then finally, the very
Sagaraja Saurada Suchita Saushilya Sagara Paradvaja Shasana Parigrahita Vichitra Chitra Kuta Girikataka Tataramya Vasata Ananya Shasaniya Pranata Bharata Makuta Tata Sugatita Padukra Griadishek Nirvartita Sarvaloka Yoga Kshema Tishita Ruchi Vita Durita Vala Matana Tanaya Balibuga Nugati Saravasa Shayana Trana Shakala Sakala Paripatana Bhayachakita Sakala Sura Munivara Bahumata Mahastra Samatya Ruhinahara Vala Matana Duraraksha Saralaksha Gandakata Povana Jangama Parijata Virada Harina Shadula Vilulita Bahu Pala Maka Kalama Rajanichara Murga Murga Yaramba Sambrita Chira Brida Nurota Trishirashirashirashrita Yatimira Nirasa Vasa Rakara Dushana Jalanidi, Shoshana Toshita, Rishikana Ghoshila, Vijaya Ghoshana, Taratara Karasaru Kandana Chanda Pavana, Visaptaraksha Sahasrana Lavana, Vilolana Mahakalabha, Asaya Shura, Arapaya Sahasa, Mahita Mahamrita Darshana Mudita Maiti Nidratara Parirambana Vibhava Viropita Vikata Viravrana Maricha Maya Mriga Charma Parikalmita Nirbara Darbhastarana Vikramaya Sodaba Vikrita Jeevita Vridha Raja Deha Didaksha Lakshita Bhakta Jana Dakshinya Kalpita Vibhuda Bhavaka Bandha Binandita Avandya Mahima Munijana Bhajana Mushita Hridaya Kalusha Sabari Moksha Sakshi Bhuta Prabhanjana Tanaya Tanaya Bhavuka Bhashita Ranjita Hridaya Sarani Suta Sharanagati Paratantri Krita Vatantriya Jadagatita Kailasha Koti Vikata Dundumi Kankala Kuta Dura Vikshepa Daksha Dakshinetara Padangushta Dara Chalana Visvasta Suhridashaya Ati Pratula Bahuvita Pigiri Dharina Vivara Yuga Padudaya Vivrata Chitra Punka Vaichitriya Vipula Buddha Shaila Mula Nipida Nipidita Ravana Rana Ranaka Janaka Chaturudadi Viharana Chatura Kapi Kulapati Hridaya Vishala Shilatala Dharana Daruna Shilimukha Apara Para Vara Parikha Parivrita Parapura Parisrita Davadahana Javana Pavana Bhava Kapivara Parishwanga Bhavita Sarvasvadana Ahita Sahodara Raksha Parigraha Visambadi Vivida Sachiva Vishrambana Samaya Samrambha Samudrimvita Sarveshwara Bhava Sakritpapanna Jana Samrakshana Dikshita Veera Satyavrata Pratishayana Bhumika Bhushita Payodi Pulina Pralayashiki Parusha Vishika Shikha Shoshita Kupara Varipura Prabala Ripukalaha Kutuka Chatula Kapikula Karatala Tulita Hritagiri Nikara Sadita Setupata Sima Simantita Samudra Dridagatita Tarumruga Varutini Niruddha Lankavaroda Vepatu Lasya Lilopadesha Deshika Danujya Gosha Gagana Charakana Kagiri Garina Tara Nigamamaya Nija Garuda Garuda Nila Lava Galita Vishavadana Sarakadana Akrita Charavana Chararana Karana Vailakshya Kunitaksha Bahuvida Raksho Balajyaksha Vaksha Kavata Patana Patima Shatopa Kopavalepa Katurata Dadani Tankriti Chatura Kathora Karmuka Vinirgata Vishankata Vishika Vitadana Vigatita Makuta Vishwala Vishavastanaya Vishrama Samaya Vishrana Samaya Vikyata Vikrama Kumbhakarana Kula Giri Vidalana Damboli Bhuta Nishtanka Kankapatra Avicharana Hutavaha Paricharana Vigatana Sarabasa Paripata Daparimita Kapiphala Jaladi Lahari Kalakalavarasa Kupita Magavaji Dabiharana Kazanuja Sakshika Rakshasa Dvandva Yuddha Aprati Dvandva Paurusha Tyambaka Samadika Ghora Stradambara Sarati Hritarata Shatrava Shatrava Satyapita Pratapa Shita Sarakrita Lavana Dasha Mukha Mukha Dashaka Nipatana Punarudaya Dara Galita Janita Dara Tarala Harihayanayana Nalina Vaja Ruchi Kachita Katala Nipatita Surata Rukusuma Vitati Suravita Ratapata Akhila Jagadika Buja Balavara Baladasha Lapana Lapana Dashaka Lavana Janita Kadana Paravasa Rajanichara Yuvati Vilapana Vachana Sama Vishaya Nigama Shikara Nikara Mukara Mukha Munivara Paripanita Abhigata Shatamaka Hutavaha Pitrapati Nirriti Varuna Pavana Danada Girisha Mukha Surapati Mudita Amita Mati Vidi Vidita Katita Nija Vibhava jaladi prashatalava vigata bhaya vibhuta paribhrida vibhoti virasayana sayita vanara pratanaugha swasamaya vigatita sugatita sahridaya sahadharma charinika vibhishana vasamvadi krita lankaishwariya nishpanna kritya kapushpita ripupaksha Pushpakaravasagati Goshpadi Krita Gaganarnava Pratignyarnavatana Kritakshana Bharata Manorata Samhita Simhasanadirudha Swamin Raghava Simha Swamin Raghava Simha Hataka Girikataka Ladaha Padatita Nikatatata Parilutita Nikala Nipati Kirita Koti Vivida Manigana Kirana Nikara Nirajita Charana Rajiva Divya Bhauma Yodhya Didaivata Pitravada Kupita Parashudara Muni Vihita Nipahanana Kadana Purva Kala Prabhava Shataguna Pratishtha Pita Dharmika Rajavamsa Shubacharita Rata Bharata Kharvita Garva Gandharva Yuta Gita Vijaya Gata Shata Shasita Madhusuta Shatrughna Sevita Pushalava Parigrihita Kula Gata Vishesha Vidivasha Parinama Damara Banita Kavivara Rachita Nijacharita Nibandana Nishmana Nivrata Sarvajana Sammanita Punarupastapita Vimanavara Vishanana Preenita Vaishravana Vishavita Yasaprapancha Panchatapanna Muni Kumara Sanjeevanamrita Preta Yuga Pravartita Karta Yuga Vrittanta Avikala Bahu Suvarna Hayamaka Sahasra Nirvahana Nirvartita Nijavarna Ashrama Dharma Sarva Karma Samaradhyā Sanatana Dharma Saketa Janapada Janidanika Jangama Taditara Jantu Jata Divya Gatidana Darshita Nitya Nisthima Vaibhava Bhavatapanata Pita Bhakta Jana Badra Rama Shri Rama Badra Namaste Punaste Namaha Shri Rama Badra Namaste Punaste Namaha Chatur Mukheshwara Mukhaihi Putra Putra Adishaline Namasita Sametaya Ramaya Grihamedine Chatur Mukheshwara Mukhaihi Putra Putra Adishaline Namasita Sametaya Ramaya Grihamedine Kavita Kataka Simha Katitam Kathora Sukumara Gumba Gambhiram Bhava Bhaya Bheshaja Metat Patata Mahavira Vaibhavam Sudiyaha Kavi Kataka Simha Katitam Kathora Sukumara Gumba Gambhiram Bhava Bhaya Bheshaja Metat Patata Mahavira Vaibhavam Sudiyaha Kavita Artika Simhaya Kalyana Gunashaline Srimate Venkateshaya Vedanta Gurave Namaha
Jai Go Radhika Lutram, Radhika Kasturi Mataji, hats off to you and so beautiful Aditya, so beautiful. Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you.
Very nice, Aditya. Very nice.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Hare Krishna, such a beautiful, it's just a transforming experience listening to you sing. And it was nice to watch you, and unfortunately the video was removed by YouTube. So, but thank you so much. Thank you for your beautiful singing. Thank you, Vilasini Mataji.
Thank you so much, Mataji.
Thank you. Hare Krishna, Preethi. Go ahead, Padma Mataji.
Such a wonderful recitation, Aditya. So, so wonderful. All blessings. Very nice, Aditya. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mataji.
So beautiful, Aditya. Such a beautiful recitation, like an icing on the cake of Preethi Vilasini Mataji's class. It was so wonderful. The whole past 2 hours is just so amazing. Thank you to both Mataji and Aditya, and hope you learn more shlokas. This is the best age to learn. Hare Bol.
Yeah, thank you.
Hare Krishna, Aditya. Such a beautiful, thank you so much for singing nicely. If you would not sing, I would never known about this song. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna, very beautiful.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Aditya, Dandvat Pranam, Srila Prabhupada, Srila Gurudev ki. Such a nicely you are explaining the tune, the lahaka is so good. Thank you, Radhe. Special mercy of Srila Prabhupada, Srila Gurudev.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you so much, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Preethi Vilasini Mataji.
Hare Bol. Thank you so much, Aditya. Thank you. Thank you for making us so happy today. It's your recital.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for
the opportunity, Preethi Vilasini Mataji.
All very special, Prabhupada. Nice, very nice. Thank you for coming. Yes, Indu Mataji.
Mataji, one second, Mataji. Aditya, what's your age?
I'm 11.
Hare Bol, thank you. Many people were asking after sharing your audio, so that's why I'm asking. Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Iti Vilasini Mataji, Hare Krishna, thank you for talking about such an important topic. And we have also spoken about this personally, and you did explain a lot of this, Mataji, in the last few weeks, maybe in the last few months to me. And I'm really grateful to you for having taken this as a special class and, you know, focused on everyone's surrender, each one of their surrender, and what works, what doesn't work, and only a surrender to the Supreme Lord and His consent is going to work. And I'm so, so grateful to you for this class, Mataji. It was very, very touching, very, very beautifully taken. And to end it with Aditya's song is just amazing, just amazing. Thank you so much, Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Indu Mataji. Thank you for your kind words. Hare Krishna. Anyone else has anything to share or say or comment? I don't know if anyone is muted. I can check and unmute.
Hare Krishna Mataji, all glories to Prabhupada, Guru Maharaj. What a wonderful beginning. What a wonderful beginning to a fantastic day. I was thinking that Gadyam itself will has the power to remove the virus. Hare Krishna.
Ram Katha, yes, Ram Katha, and the beautiful recitals and the classes and everything from morning, the recitals from morning, yes. And Aditya, very, 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 oh my God, I don't even know how he did it.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. All glories to Prabhupada. All glories to Prabhupada, because even in this time of us, you know, in this situation where so much negative is going around, we have this opportunity to sit in our homes and actually utilize our time properly. And auspicious day, wonderful. Thank you, Mata. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hi, Krishna. I just want to express my gratitude for being able to hear the Ramayana narrated by the Acharya of Ramayana narrations today. The perfect person to hear from about Ramayana today. You know, thank you so much. And Aditya was really, really impressive. For whether she be 11 years old or 60 years old or anything between or after, it was extremely impressive recitation. So wonderful, wonderful job, Aditya. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Preethi Vilasini Mataji. Thank you very, very much. Very beautiful class, Mataji.
Then, if there are no more comments or questions, we can end the call. Thank you all so much, and thank you, Aditya, again and again for this very, very ecstatic 15 minutes. It just flew. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Preethi Vilasini Mataji, for the opportunity for this.
Thanks to everyone. Hare Krishna. So we can end the call. Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Prapasindubhyaivacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Anantakoti Vaishnav Vrinda Ki Jai Shila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Srimad Valmiki Ramayan Ki Jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. Anantakoti Vaishnav Vrinda Ki Jai Ho. Aditya Ki Jai. Thank you so much.
Aditya Ki Jai.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.